know, why worry about something that you've got no control over? So that was kind of what inspired to write this book, because it did occur to me that if there's more people thinking like that, that's probably not, you know, we're probably not on the way to solving the problem. And now, sort of 7 years on from where Gore was in 2007, and he made that talk, we're no closer to any of the targets that he set. So after I wrote that book, something interesting happened. This is going to be... It's a bit sensitive, this. So I met this guy, Tony Ryan. He's the Pro Vice Chancellor at the University of Sheffield, and he happens to be kind of leading a global initiative called SHINE, which is looking at the future of energy, really, future of energy going forwards. And he asked me if I wanted to write a book with him. He'd read everything now, and he really liked that, and he kind of could perceive that actually, while he was going around the world and speaking to the science community, that what he needed to do, what he had, was a comms problem, and he needed to break out of that. I'd always wanted to write a science book, fascinated by science. I did politics as a degree. As I said, I work in comms. I haven't got the authority to write a science book, so we decided to collaborate and work on that together. And really, that's why I'm here today. And to get to the point of what I'm going to talk about now, growth or sustainability, that's what I'm here to talk about. Because me and Tony thought that what we were going to write was a book about the future of energy, and actually what we ended up writing about was a book about sociology and politics, because that's for us where the real issues lie. So remember to go down. So right, so let's start in 2008 then, with the kind of global crash. You know, the market's going to, you know from nowhere, you know, boom and bust is over, Gordon Brown said. He delayed the election. I was advising the Labour Party at the time. Came as a complete shock to everybody when he didn't hold the election, when everybody thought he was going to, and he delayed a few years and ended up losing, because this happened. No one saw it. Collapse of the banking system came very, very close in this country to a complete collapse. We were a few hours away from all the cash points not working and not being able to pull money out, and bank accounts being frozen. And by pumping in a load of like sovereign wealth, they managed to stabilise the markets. And that did have a big impact on the way that people thought, and then a big impact on the career of Gordon Brown. And what we started to hear was really these kind of phrases, and these are three phrases made by different phrases from each of the different members of the party, all kind of saying the same thing. Can't really remember which is which, but I know that they're not in order. But you know, that's kind of all broadly saying the same thing, that what we need to do is we need to learn lessons of that, and we need to do something different. We haven't really done anything different. What we're kind of faced with now is really these three guys, for want of a better word, are engaged in a pissing contest to decide that who is the best at running a market economy. And really, all their plans for the future kind of merge, come down to one thing, and that is this, you know, is growth. That's what they're all talking about, obsessing over the figures, about growth and the best way to get growth, and whether it's you know, whether it's through austerity measures that the Conservatives are very keen on, or the revisiting Keynesian economics that worked so well in the 1930s that Ed Miliband and the Labour Party is so fond on. But really, fundamentally, growth is at the heart of the recovery, as far as the politicians are concerned. And what's happened in the meantime is that all the kind of work on sustainability has been seen as a kind of nice to have, as something that is an option, is a benefit, and once we get growth back, then yes, we'll go and look at sustainability again. Certainly Cameron believes that getting rid of the red tape surrounding sustainability and green politics would be a real advantage to the economy at the moment. Now, what I'm going to talk to you about today is whether or not that's true, whether or not growth is coming back, and secondly, whether or not we've got a choice, whether or not that is really a choice that you can offer to the electorate. Can we choose between growth or sustainability? So, without kind of giving too much away, this is really what I think is fundamentally the problem with the economy that we've got at the moment. Because infinite growth in a finite system is absolutely no problem to economists. It's been no problem to economists for the last, well, since Adam Smith started writing, really. But it's anathema to physicists and chemists and scientists. Infinite growth in a finite system is just impossible. And this is really at the heart of the problem with the market economy. Because this symbol, does anybody know what it means? This is the symbol for equilibrium. This is a stable state. And our economy is either expanding or contracting, another word for depression. There is no stable state in the market economy. So what we've either got is depression, a contraction, or growth. There is no point at which the system that we live in at the moment is stable. Now, I have to say, I'm no kind of, you know, wigwam. I don't home educate my kids or live in a teepee or weave my own yoghurt. I drove to here in a German car. I'll be going back in it. I very much like the lifestyle that we've got now. I'm not here to come and tell you that you need to do things differently as an individual, or that we, you know, this isn't a rich man coming to say, right, well, you don't need to live by us. But I think that we've got some choices to make in the next 20 years, and we're not facing up to them. And that's really what I'm going to talk about today. So this is kind of the starting point for the book that I wrote with Tony, and this is a guy called John Beddington, and this is a paper that everybody should read and very few people have. He wrote it in 2009, and it's a kind of quite harrowing document. It was certainly the starting point for the book and the first thing Tony gave me to read, and I did not enjoy reading it at all. What Beddington says is really he highlighted four key issues that are kind of converging at the moment, the biggest challenges that humanity face. One of them is climate change, popularly talked about in the media as the biggest challenge that we face at the moment, but fundamentally not the biggest challenge that we face at the moment. Climate change, we're living through it now, will play out over decades. It will play over a timescale of decades, and we've got a chance to adapt. We don't know what's going to happen. We've got a chance to adapt to what is happening. Long, long before it becomes too late to do anything about the climate, the other three problems are going to raise their head. And the other three problems are more important because we're living through them now. This little baby is a Filipino girl who was born in 2011. She's citizen 7 billion. She's the 7th billionth citizen born on the planet. Now, she's not really the 7th billionth citizen, but she was identified as a totem of the 7 billion citizen by the United Nations Population Fund to really draw attention to the fact that population growth, explosive population growth, it is an issue. Now, what happened was for a few days around October the 11th, the beginning of November, there was lots of articles about population growth and how important it is and everything, and then the debate moved on and that was kind of all forgotten. And really, you know, this kind of feels like nothing new. I was born in 1966, 47-year-olds, around 50 years. When I was born, there was 3 billion people in the world. I've seen the population sort of grow to, you know, more than double in my lifetime. 80 years ago, citizen 2 billion was born. So there are lots of people alive today who were around when the population of the world was only 2 billion people. And one of the reasons that we haven't noticed it so much, and I know we've got a very international audience, so when I normally say this, this won't play out quite as well as it does normally, is that in the UK, population has grown very slowly. We're about 10% up from where we are, you know, in the 1970s. And we're kind of aging as a population, and birth rates are going down, and all those sorts of things. So we haven't noticed it so much over here, but that doesn't mean that it's not happening and it's not really important. Because as you'll see, for almost all of human history, population growth hasn't been an issue at all. I mean, this is the Industrial Revolution kind of kicked off around about here. You've got millennia of kind of no growth at all. And you can see even like the move to coal and stuff doesn't really have much impact. We hit citizen 1 billion around about here, around about the 18th century. But then something happens when we get to the 1900s, and then bang, there's an awful lot of people. And all the projections say that it's not going to stop. The projection that I'm keenest on, the one that seems to make most sense of me, is that around about the middle of the century, there's going to be 10 billion people. Now, that's 3 billion people more than we are now. That's as many people as were alive in the world when I was born, and it didn't feel particularly sparsely populated back then. And really, what the challenge for me and what I was interested in was really, well, how are we going to manage that? How do we manage a global population of 10 billion people? Can we? Is it something that we can manage? What can we do about that? And really, this should be the starting point, because this is a global problem. These people are not all arriving in the same place. This bit at the bottom, the dark bit, that's the developed world. That's the OECD countries. As you can see, it's hardly risen there at all. But something's going on in the developing world. It's a huge amount of population growth. So with this population growth comes inordinate inequality. because most of the people being born are going to be scrabbling around for the smallest amount of resources. So in terms of kind of like understanding how that happened, briefly, 350 years ago, we were like any other animal. We were no different to, you know, the kind of like, you know, apes in the jungle, or the lions on the savannah, or the, you know, or the weasel in the, you know, in the undergrowth. We kind of lived, we were locked into the solar cycle. All our energy, give or take, a bit that we were getting from tides, came from the sun. And the way that happens is, you know, the plants grow, you know, they take in energy, photosynthesis through the leaves, convert that into wood, and we kind of use that to run the economy. And then 350 years ago in Britain, something changed. And what happened was something that was, what happened was something that was kind of like, that'll be quite familiar to us today. So we get to about 350 years ago, global population of the world. Anyone here into organic farming? Think of that figure, 600 million, organic farming. That's the number of people that organic farming will support. 600 million people in the world, majority of it subsistence living. Deforestation in the UK had taken place, you know, way before that. Within most of the major urban centres, 350 years, there were no trees at all. And wood, the wood economy in Elizabethan times was kind of very important. They didn't just use it for firewood and for fuel. They used it to build ships and houses. Timber was at the heart of all their construction. And there were a load of laws introduced to stop people from chopping their own firewood. Now, the solution that the Elizabethans came up with was to look around for an alternative to wood, and they found, particularly in this part of the world, they found a material called sea coal. It was seams of coal that were largely found at the mouths of rivers. It'd been known about since Roman times, but not really been harvested at all. But suddenly, there was a shift from a wood economy to a coal economy. And that's kind of where the Industrial Revolution came from. Because what coal is nothing more than buried sunshine. Buried sunshine over millions and millions of years ago. So if you like, what you can think of coal is like a kind of energy bank account where energy has been stored, the sun comes down, the same as the wood economy, it hits the trees, or it allows the plants to photosynthesize. Some of those plants are eaten by sea creatures, they die, and they turn into oil and gas, and the wood turns into coal. All our fossil fuels is basically ancient stores of buried sunshine. And the other interesting thing was that we started coal, energy needed to be commoditized once coal was introduced. And you know, you can't go into you go to the woods and chop your own firewood. You can't go and mine your own coal. It became commoditized. The means of production had kind of changed into the hands of the few. Population changed, and the Industrial Revolution kind of carried that process forwards. So what happens with the Industrial Revolution is we end up from the population doubling once every 1,000 years, it starts to double once every 150 years. But the sort of fossil fuel economy isn't really the end of the story, it's only the beginning, because the real impact on population growth comes from a kind of byproduct of the fossilized fuels. It's the Haber-Bosch process. Does anybody know what this is? I didn't know what it was until about 3 years ago. It's one of the most important developments in human history. Haber-Bosch, Haber was a very sort of a rather eccentric German scientist, and what he worked out was how to artificially create ammonia. Now, ammonia, you can use ammonia to make, it contains nitrogen, you can use that to as artificial fertilizer. Prior to the invention of the Haber-Bosch process, just before the First World War, we were kind of, again, living on the edge of the food supply. In the UK, at a sort of micro level, we'd had our own doubling of the population as the Industrial Revolution had taken place, and we were farming areas of the colonies to kind of feed the population. Haber-Bosch process allowed fertilizer to be made artificially. Prior to this, almost all the fertilizer in the world was kind of fossilized bird guano from Peru and Chile. And this really, really did change things. This allowed kind of like the industrialization of farming and really increased the crop yields. So that was the first thing that happened. And then the second thing that happened was around about 1950, a guy called Norman Borlaug developed two different strains of plants. One was short stem wheat, which was a genetic modification that meant that the wheat just had a shorter stem, so that more of the energy was converted into food. And this, he did the same for rice as well. And really, with those two genes, those two genetically modified crops, we ended up with the kind of, you know, the kind of golden age of farming, where you know, we were able to 25 kilos from you know, 1 kilo of nitrogen, as opposed to 10 kilos prior to what Borlaug had done. And this kind of like led to kind of like, you know, 25 years of cheap food that we enjoyed at the end of the 20th century. But what's kind of telling is that Borlaug, who's you know, won the Nobel Prize for Peace because he did save 1 billion people, would have starved to death without him. And he talked what he'd done as a temporary success in man's war against hunger and deprivation. He didn't think that it was going to go on forever. And he was right. Because where we are today is we're kind of at the end of what we can do with the Green Revolution. And we're kind of at the end of kind of the amount of crop yields that we can get. And we're a world where you know, our economy is underpinned by cheap oil. When we think of oil, we normally think of the transport infrastructure that we've got, and we'll also think about it, oil-fired power stations, so we'll think of it as a source of electricity. But actually, oil is much more ingrained in the economy than that. So we build with oil. To make 38 tons of, you know, to make a ton of aluminium takes 38 tons of oil. Same for steel, 8.5 tons. So that's the amount of oil that we consume when we make 1 ton of this. And more importantly than the fact that we build with oil, I think, is the fact that we actually eat oil. The Haber-Bosch process, as I said, is at the heart of it. That uses a huge amount of oil in the production of ammonia. So 10 tons of nitrogen fertilizer, that's 6.8 tons of oil. The implication of this is that when the oil runs out, the food will run out, because there isn't another way of making that at the moment. And kind of a further example of this is if you look at the way that population has grown, which is the big black line there, you can see it's almost in kind of lockstep with the consumption of oil, which again, exactly the same as the consumption of fertilizer. So these three things, fertilizer, oil consumption, population growth, are really, really kind of integrally linked. And the result is that today we're kind of at a point where we're squeezing the Earth's resources like never before. There's 7 billion people now, not 600 million. And we live a very pleasant lifestyle in the OECD countries. We eat a lot of meat, we enjoy a lot of dairy. There are 3 billion people in the BRIC countries, the developing economies, who all want that kind of lifestyle. And that means that the competition for resources, whatever resources are left, is going to massively increase. Now, we're making up the shortfall because we're not producing enough at the moment. We're burning through the fossil record at about 20 million years every year. That's going to run out at some point. You know, we cannot sit here and argue about when it is going to run out, but it is going to run out at some point. And we're using 1.5 times the Earth's GDP annually. That means that the natural resources that we're digging up out of the ground, they're all kind of close to running out as well. And it's not just oil, it's things like lithium for batteries, rare earth metals, all those sorts of things. There's a real kind of scramble for resources now that's only going to hot up as the opportunity to live a kind of like the kind of Western style lifestyles kicks on as the BRIC economies merge through. The question is then, what distinguishes energy from any other technology? And for me, it's the scale of the problem. So these figures are kind of out of date. I mean, you know, 2011, 40 million terawatts of energy. All the projections, all of them, suggest that we're going to need twice as much energy in 2050 against the backdrop of declining resources. Now, to put that into context for you, I mean, you know, these are big numbers. 10 billion terawatt, 10 trillion terawatts is all the energy used in the world in 1990, around the time that most of you were born. So we're going to have to do almost half of that again to get to 28 terawatts. And it's, you know, this, and the scale is, you know, that's huge. So the, and these are where all the projections are going. These are, you know, this, some say more, some say less. But even if it's 25, we can't. We're going to have to use that. You know, if we save all the energy in the world that we've got today, so all of it, and all of that that we're using with fossil fuels that we're going to run out of sometime, and all the nuclear and all the wind and everything, we're still going to have to create as much again from clean energy sources in our lifetimes, in my lifetime, let alone yours. So in terms of putting forward a kind of plan and a strategy for what we need to do, this is it really. Simply produce 10 to 20 terawatts of clean energy a year. There's also a real challenge of finding an effective storage medium. We've got kind of three vectors, you know, systems for carrying energy from where it is to the consumers. So with oil, the brilliant thing about oil is it's liquid. It can be pumped, it can be piped, it can be poured. Transportation's really easy. Coal, can't pump that. So if we're going to look for an alternative to oil, it'd be good to have a liquid in place. Because, you know, we need to exploit the existing infrastructure. We haven't got time to put a new infrastructure in place. Can't move to a different kind of economy. And we've also got to start, in terms of fuel, we've got to start considering the cost of cleaning afterwards. Coal is the cheapest form of energy there is. And the reason that it looks so cheap is that nobody factors in anything other than the cost of pulling it out of the ground. No one facts in the cost of making it, like you have to when you say how much wind costs or how much wave power costs, or no one factors in how much it costs to clean it up afterwards. And in order for us to succeed, we need to be able to hit a target price of about 10 cents per kilowatt. So that's kind of what we need to do. So the question is, how doable is that? Well, as we can see, that coal is the cheapest way of doing that at the moment. And the most expensive way would be using batteries, which are some way off 10 cents per kilowatt hour by a factor of several thousand percent. Right, so the final point I need to make is that we need to do this with existing technology. So a lot of people, the sort of Jeremy Clarksons of this world, think that technology is going to race in and save the day. The reality is that there's no cavalry coming. There is no. This has all got to be done with the technology that we've got today. There are some gaps there, some R&D needed, but there is not a new fuel coming along that we're going to have to use instead. We've got to use existing technology. And beware of all these sort of enthusiastic PR-grabbing initiatives and the stories that you see in the media. You know, we're some way off being able to do that now. And the reality is, there's a book by Vaclav Smil called Energy Transitions, which I don't recommend any of you read. It's a very, very dull book. But what he states quite compellingly is that, you know, energy transitions tend to take at least, you know, 35 years for coal. After it's reached 5% of the population, you're looking at another half century before it comes through. There's no evidence to suggest that the transition to another form of energy is going to be any quicker. In fact, it's probably going to be a lot longer because of the scale involved and the technology needed. So you know, we are stuck with what we've got. So the next question: what can we do with existing technology? So could we do this with oil? You know, could we do this with oil? Yes, we can carry on with oil, which is what we're doing now. This is the default position. It's probably unlikely that we can increase production beyond where we are at the moment. You know, we may be able to a little, but you know, demand's going to be much higher, which means that the only time energy ever gets written about is when the bills go up. Those bills are just going to carry on going up. This is just the start. It's not the end. Energy's going to get much more expensive. And also, with oil, mind-boggling supply issues that I wasn't aware of when I wrote the book. I was at a talk the other week about maritime security, and the guy there from the Navy was saying that the oil that we get, you know, where does that come from? I didn't know, but it's basically, there's a tanker, a sort of, you know, million-ton tanker, backed up every 300 miles from Portsmouth right the way to the Gulf, coming through every 300 miles, so coming through past Somalia, up the Suez Canal, across the Mediterranean, round the Gibraltar, up the English Channel, busiest shipping lanes in the world, some real kind of like trigger points in terms of you know, like political hotspots and so on. You know, this is not the easy, this is not the safe option. You know, it looks like the supply that we've got is a kind of thread of cotton going all the way to the Middle East. And so, so you've always got the answer. What about natural gas? Natural gas and fracking, we hear a lot about that, don't we? Well, you know, gas is greener, but it's not green. We're still going to have all the climate change problems that we've got. And, you know, as we've seen at the moment, no one knows what the consequences of global warming are going to be. We just know that they're probably going to be something that we're unprepared for. And as you've seen with the floods, even, you know, at this stage, it's, you know, it's going to cost billions of pounds to clear that up. And what are we going to get next year? Is it going to be another wet winter like this one? Or is it going to be a freezing cold one where we had snow 7 months in the year like we did a couple of years ago? That's going to be expensive, and it's going to take, you know, a lot of time to kind of like mitigate that. The other thing is that fracking is not the answer. Fracking, for all its benefits, and you know, there aren't really many, we've only got 20 years of energy from fracking. And the other thing is that it encourages short-termism. You know, it encourages energy consumption. You know, as I'm talking to you now about these issues with energy, there are ships laden with Christmas cracker gifts on their way to the UK from China and India. That's kind of what we're spending our energy on at the moment. We're not using it as a sort of valuable resource. We're kind of like chucking it against the wall. And using natural gas is not going to help us be all right for the next 20 years, and then we've just got this problem to face up then. We should be using these resources in the interim to come up with a long-term solution. Coal, this is really where rubber meets the road in energy, because it's so cheap. If you're running a third world country in Africa or you know, one of the African states, and you're looking at how to provide energy for your citizens, where are you going to look beyond coal? 3.6 pence per kilowatt. That's obviously what you're going to look at. China added 2 gigawatts coal-fired energy every week last year. That's kind of mind-blowing. And that will continue, because there isn't really, you know, as I said, what's not factored in is the cost of cleaning it up or the cost of actually making the coal itself. So, oh, God, this is a, sorry, I've not got my head around this at all. But okay, so coal. So we can't really do it with nuclear. We can't really do it with fossil fuels either. So there is one at scale, fully developed. It's been around 50 years. It hits all the technologies we've got, and that is the ever popular nuclear power. You know, everyone's a big fan of nuclear, aren't they? Well, you know, and could we solve the energy problem with nuclear? In principle, yes. Yes, we could. We could do it, and you know what? We could probably do it more safely than we do now. Without going into too many details, the kind of technology that we've got to make nuclear energy is a byproduct of the weapons program, which kind of means that every nuclear power station in the world is a prototype. That's why it's never kind of reduced down in cost. Every time they build one, they build it from scratch. They're not built to a template like gas or coal, and there are a lot safer ways of making nuclear energy. You could use thorium instead of uranium and so on. But the thing is, you know, would we want to use nuclear? Because even if you kind of accept that, you know, even if, you know, the most pro-nuclear and you think that it is really safe, the maths involved are really terrifying. So at the moment in the world, there's, you know, less than 500 operational power stations, and there's 60 under construction. So to give us the 10 to 20 terawatts of energy that we need, all we need is an additional 11,000 power stations. And we need them. That's building a nuclear power station somewhere in the world every day for the next 50 years. Right? But don't worry, because there's not enough uranium to do that. So if you're anti-nuclear, don't worry, that's not going to happen. We could do it with plutonium, though. We could use a fast breeder reactor. There's only one in the world at the moment, but that's quite clever in the fact that it makes its own, kind of makes its own fuel. We need 10,000 of them. The problem with them is that they only have a life cycle of about 35 to 40 years. So we'd be committed to building one in the world somewhere forever. but actually you don't need to worry about this at all, because we haven't even got enough nuclear physicists to decommission the power stations that we've got at the moment, let alone build the new ones. So we can just forget nuclear. I think that, you know, there is a space for nuclear, and I think that a kind of tripling of the of what we've got at the moment would be, you know, would be reasonable. There is another way. There's another nuclear form of energy. Brian Cox likes this, doesn't he? Fusion. This is kind of been around since I was a kid. It's been 30 years away. Fission is splitting the atoms. Fusion is smashing them together and taking advantage of the energy in the strong nuclear force. We're not able to do this because of the massive issues involved. This happens in the middle of the sun, which is a huge, you know, celestial object. It happens in the middle of nuclear explosions, where it's actually a fission, a nuclear explosion, split the atom, that gives the compression and containment element to give the pressures that allows fusion to take place. Whether somebody wants to start exploding a hydrogen bomb in a reactor every day to give you fusion is another question. But the reality is that we've never been able to do this and create more energy than we've used in terms of making it. So, you know, it's 30 years away, and it might be 30 years away forever. There's never really been the investment in fusion to see whether or not it works. We'd have to invest in something in the order of £3 trillion to find out. Might be worth a bet, but we'd have to invest that money in the knowledge that it might not come off. Right, so now the alternatives to nuclear. Normally, in the media that we've got, this is set up as a binary argument. If there's any journalism students, any PR students, love binary arguments in this country. So is it nuclear, or is it alternatives? Which one is it? Which one is it? Well, it's definitely not this. Definitely not this, because there are so many problems with wind and wave that it can't possibly solve the problem. Now, that does not mean that there isn't a place for this. There really is a place for this. We need as much as this as we can get. But the problem is that with the most efficient wind turbines and the most efficient wave machines, we're kind of maxed out in terms of what we can get from hydro at the moment. We could probably only take about 4 terawatts out of the atmosphere. So that's good. 4 terawatts is better than none. But the other thing is that, as well as there just not being enough, there's problems with what you call intermittency, right? You can't store electricity. So when we all turn our kettles on at half time of the football or at the end of Coronation Street or whatever, somebody at the power station is ramping that up. He's making sure that there's enough power to power everybody. And then when we turn the kettles off, they're pulling the brakes off. Electricity is a kind of delivery system for energy, and it's a kind of like just enough. The problem with this is that, you know, there isn't wind when you need it. It's not always windy when you want it to be, or you know, windy, you know, wind when everyone's turning the kettles on. And that kind of creates huge issues in terms of trying to match supply to demand. So Denmark can supply about 21% of its electricity needs by wind power. Well, it can when the wind's blowing, but there were 60 days last year when it didn't get anything from wind at all. So this is not this. The problem is this is not either wind or nuclear. We need wind. It's just not the answer. That kind of thing that's playing out in the media is just a sideshow. Next is the hydrogen economy. Jeremy Clarkson, a big fan of this. There are no reserves of hydrogen in the world. It makes more sense to think of hydrogen like electricity as a means of storing energy from other sources. We can't use it in the system that we've got. Although it's a gas, it's the lightest gas, it's only one atom. Storage is a real problem. If you're going to get it as a liquid, you need to store it at, you know, super cool temperatures. There's so much embedded energy involved in putting a hydrogen infrastructure together, we can just forget it. And actually, the same squared for the battery economy. We use batteries because they're portable and they're convenient. That's the only reason we use them. If I was to discharge every battery that had ever been created in history now, I'd have enough power to power the world for 12 minutes. You know, batteries are just literally just a non-starter. So that kind of all seems pretty bleak. But the reality is that we have got one big card to play, and we're not playing it. And that's solar power. All the energy, as I said, that we get comes from the sun. And, you know, for a long time people have been talking about solar. Henry Ford said, you know, if he was down to his last dollar, he'd bet it on solar power. And really, what I think that we've got now, the challenge is, if we've got enough energy to get us to the middle of the century. But we really need to be investing in solar, because this is the only option. This is the only option. And this is a massive nuclear reactor 93 million miles away. And all we need to do is capture just 1 hour of the sunshine that hits the world in a year, and we'll have enough to power the world for an entire year. The amount of sunshine hitting the world in a year is more than all the energy that has ever been used in human history. And those two statements that I've made will still be true in 500 years' time. But we're not there yet. We know how. We know what needs to be done. We just don't really know how to do it. So this little bit of Nevada here, with 10% efficiency of solar cells, that would give enough energy. That will give you enough energy to power the whole of the United States of America. So that's good. But the problem is that, you know, they're not efficient enough yet, solar cells. They're getting more efficient, but they're not getting efficient quick enough, and they're really expensive. So we could fit out the UK, and at the moment, if we were to put solar panels on every roof in the world, we still wouldn't have enough energy. We still wouldn't be at that 20 terawatts that we need. But solar is really attractive at scale. You know, if we were to 1% of the Sahara, cover that in solar panels, and we'd have enough energy to meet the world's energy needs. The problem with that, again, is the transportation issues. To kind of get that energy from there to the UK by cable, take cables the size of my body all the way from Africa to here. There just isn't enough natural materials in the world to be able to do that. And the way that we can do that, this at the moment, is using really, really expensive elements like platinum and gold, and we need to be able to use it with a lot cheaper. And what we need to get to is to a kind of like solar cells that is easiest to apply as house paint, and just as cheap. And that's kind of where the research in solar is moving towards. But it's moving towards it as a snail pace. And the reason it's moving towards it as a snail's pace is because energy is a global issue, but we are attempting to solve it at a national level. So there's no government, there's no investment in solar in the UK because we don't get sun here. So we don't invest in it at all. And I've had meetings with some of the big energy companies like Centrica, who recognize that this is a real problem, that they are not investing in the areas that they need to, because they're just looking at delivering shareholder value in a kind of quite a narrow space. But, you know, in terms of being optimistic, it is starting to happen. Germany, you know, categorically said they were going to abandon their nuclear program. They've got a solar park in Germany. But depending on where you are in the world, basically the more sun you get, the more efficient they are. This farm in the USA is about the same size as Germany, but it's actually about 35% more efficient because it gets more sunshine. So there's a lot of work still to be done here. And this is kind of the holy grail, because the at Caltech in California, there's a guy called Nate Lewis, who's a big help in writing the book, and he's one of the leaders in renewable energy. He's working on artificial photosynthesis, and that is being able to sort of create artificial leaves that, instead of splitting sunlight into water, will split it into hydrogen. Once you've got hydrogen, you can start to do different things in terms of ways of storing it. So I think that this is probably about 35 to 40 years away, but there's reason to be optimistic that this would be the way that we would be able to provide liquid fuel, and what we need to do is to work out how we're going to get to this point. And another thing is that there are alternatives available today. Methanol, in Germany during the war they ran cars on methanol. In South Africa they made methanol to run the cars during the years of apartheid, when they were, the oil imports were prohibited. And even in California they had a very, very successful methanol a program that was cancelled by Arnold Schwarzenegger when he got in. And the thing is, there's a book called The Methanol Economy that is really compelling, written by a Nobel Prize winner. And the reason that we don't use methanol, we could make methanol by carbon capture from coal-powered power stations. We know how to make it. It will run in cars. We've got the infrastructure there. But the reason, again, is it's not competitive when compared to biodiesel, which is the ethanol that that's a completely different form of fuel. That's done by growing sugar cane or other crops like that. So this has kind of been abandoned, but we should. I definitely think we should look at this again. We're not there yet, and there's no perfect solution. But solar, I think, is really the only card that we've got to play, and really the strategy that we've got for the government is right. Well, how are we going to get there? How are we going to bridge the gap between the fossil fuel economy and the solar economy? And that really brings me to the biggest challenge of all, because as I said at the start, we started writing an energy book. I was quite optimistic at the end and thought, God, there's a lot more we can do than I thought that we're doing. So why aren't we doing anything? Because we aren't doing any of these things at the moment. And that kind of like brings me back to what I said at the start, which is my expertise, which is kind of communication and the media. And this is really the starting point for another talk, but I think that the biggest challenge of all that we've got is complacency. It's that this doesn't really bother me. There are lots of things that we can all do on an individual level. You know, actually screwing in, the low energy light bulbs and driving a high mileage car does make a difference. But it's complacency, and I don't blame us. I kind of think that we've got to look at the way that we consume information about the world. Because although I said it's not the biggest problem, I've purposely not mentioned climate change, because if I do one of these talks and I mention climate change, I just get embroiled in an argument about whether or not climate change is being exaggerated, it's kind of, that really is a sideshow. And I'm going to leave you with this thought now, and this is kind of about the way that news is reported. Okay, this is, you can contest the figures if you like, but that's a fact. I'd go on television and say that, and kind of have been. 99.9% of scientists, accept climate change. There isn't really a discussion about it. Right? That's the percentage of the UK population, I believe that. Right, now why is that? Why is that? Why do people think that it's been they think it's been exaggerated. The 65% think there isn't responsible or it's being exaggerated. And the reason for that is that we've got a very binary way of reporting things in the media. So, my first book came out, was about inefficiency in large organisations. I was in I went on Radio 4 and did an interview, and I was up against somebody from the TUC who accused me of being really right-wing because I was saying that, I was having a go at the public sector and I was having a go at the workers and saying workers were lazy and da-da-da-da. And then I moved over to Bush House and did an interview with the World Service where I was up with somebody from the CBI who accused me of being an anti-capitalist and saying that I was... saying that big businesses were wrong. I wasn't saying either of those things. I was just pointing out something that I'd seen, which is inefficiency in large organisations. Now, what will happen is, if I go on the Today programme and talk about this, they will bring on somebody to talk against me. They'll bring on Nigel Lawson, won't they? It's because what they like is a balanced argument. We want a balanced argument on the BBC, and it's not fair. There are people who don't believe in climate change, so we should get them on to put their side of the story. Okay, so we've got, I'm saying that actually skews things, and it makes it look like it's 50-50, but you might argue that actually in the interest of balance that's the right thing to do, in which case I've just got two words to say to you before I go, and this might not play out with all of you, and those two words are Jimmy Savile. Jimmy Savile is an issue that the BBC have decided there is no balanced view to take on Jimmy Savile. What Jimmy Savile did is abhorrent and it's wrong. So Jimmy Savile is only ever reported negatively. Right, now I would say that if we look at Operation U-Tree and how many people have been arrested, there's probably more than 0.01% who think that what Jimmy Savile did was okay. And I would imagine that some of those people might be willing to go on television and put that case forwards. Right, now that's ludicrous, isn't it? Why would you get somebody on to say that, to support the case of Jimmy Savile? And I think that that's equally applies to climate change, and we need to look at a different way of reporting and a different way of telling the stories. So that's really, something for the other day. But if you are interested in finding out more about this and the science involved, then Project Sunshine was out, and there's a much shorter version which will be out in The Guardian later this year. So thanks very much.
Minutes. anybody would like to ask a question of Steve? Have you got any questions at all?
Yeah. Steve, you're much more positive towards the end than I expected. So essentially you're saying we have got a real problem with energy.
Yeah.
And you carry on. It's not going to get resolved by about 2050. That's really the end of it, unless we turn to using solar power. And now is the time to start to think about that. Otherwise, we won't be ready for it when we come to that situation.
Yeah, well done. That's exactly what I'll say.
Okay. I mean, interestingly enough, with this audience, you have got a very much an international mix. And some of these energy issues are playing out right across the countries here. When you've got China represented here, you've got Nigeria, you've got Greece, you've got all sorts of countries represented. Do you think those are the climate change thing that you focused on? I can understand why you hesitated to talk about it, but given events like the Philippine typhoon, what we're seeing here in the UK, the heavy snows and stuff, don't you think that's starting to click with people that actually we may have been fed a lie, there really is a problem?
I think that where I stand on climate change is I believe that climate change is a problem. I mean, I didn't want to be disingenuous there. I've got no doubt at all. However, I kind of think that actually, if we don't sort the energy out, then it won't matter at all. Yeah. If we move to a solar economy, we'll sort climate change out. If we don't, you know what? This is not about saving the planet. Planet will be fine without us. It'll be fine without us here. And I think that what's incontrovertible, is that we will move back to a solar economy. And the only question is what state we're in when we get there. Because we could be in a state like we are now, and we could decide to actually sustainability is the most important thing, and actually the lifestyles that we've got now are better, and maybe we don't need to upgrade a phone every 12 months. And I think that you need regulation. Ooh, you know, no one likes that. You need regulation to do that. You can't rely on individuals to do that for a whole host of reasons. So that needs to be regulated. But I think that the alternative is that we could go back and live like we did, in pre-industrial society, where there's 600 million people living a subsistence existence, and the only, human muscle and animal muscle is the only kind of energy that we've got, really.
Conscious that people have got lectures to go to now, but if anybody would like to come and continue the discussion with Steve, we're going to be up in RB104 for the next 20 or 30 minutes. You're very welcome to come and have a chat with Steve. I personally would like to talk a little bit more about how you move businesses from the short-term focus on shareholder value to a much more long-term legacy approach to doing business, which tries to take these things into consideration. But you're welcome to come join us in RB104 if you'd like to. But can I just say thank you very much to Steve again.
Thank you.